Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
Toxic masculinity.
Anti-masculine Gillette commercial.
War on masculinity.
It makes like every man look like a misogynist.
Beating the bad out of men.
I think you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur, a relic of the Cold War.
Oh, you're going the right way for a smack bottom, and I don't care who knows it.
This is the What and the Why podcast for the week ending the 18th of January, 2019.
No, stop getting Bond wrong!
Greetings, it's the Why podcast, aka the What and the Why, and the name's Marshall. Tim Marshall. Also featuring the near Manchester man of mystery, 006.
Ernst Stavros Waywell.
I'll come back to you on that. Now, 006 has been sending me coded messages this week, instructing me not to mention at all the B word, by which I think he means Brexit. He's also contacted me via some CIA soundwave gadget which has beamed messages into my brain to insist that we don't mention the T word either.
Indeed.
And I think by that he might mean Trump. So, if we can't mention B and we can't talk about T, then what can we talk about? Well, on a serious note, there is a discussion to be had around the biggest espionage scandal since Watergate, namely the Leeds United spying on opposition training sessions. You've got to bear with us on that. There is some geopolitics here. There's also things we lost in the mire, a news roundup of stories which didn't make headlines, but I reckon actually tell you what's really going on in the world. Gillette had a close shave, and if you think that's an awful pun, you'd not only be right, but you might ask the question, are virtuous people funny? David, or should I say Waywell, David Waywell. What was that weird name you came up with at the beginning?
Ernst Stavros Waywell. It's the it's Bond's greatest nemesis, isn't it? Blofeld.
Thank you.
The man with no earlobes.
Yes, as so often. How's your week?
Busy. I've been cartooning for about 4 days. I drew a huge cartoon strip, which I've sent off, hoping to sell it to somebody. So
cool. I'm liking that. Well, that's it, right, you know.
Oh, sorry, I was supposed to ask you, how's your week been?
No, we both know we don't really care about each other's other weeks.
I care. I saw you at school yesterday, giving a...
Oh, bless you. Yeah. I went to a school, gave a little talk, and it's really, it's challenging, but I tell you, it also gives lie to the idea of the snowflake generation. So many, and these are mostly sixth formers, top. They're a top lot, mostly. Now, Spygate, look, regular listeners, bear with us. It's an ongoing obligatory football chat. Leeds United found that they've been spying on Derby County, their training session. It got even bigger this week where the FA and the English Football League has become involved. And David, I am easy about talking about it. You actually want to talk about it. Why?
I was going to actually write about it this week in the sense of I love the idea that because I how do you pronounce your manager's name? I can never...
Bielsa.
Go on. Bielsa. I love the fact he did the PowerPoint presentation. And he went into this great detail about sports science and explaining the rationale behind his approach to football, which is like really scientific, yet people can't accept that. They've got to have some sort of spying mystery to explain it away, because somehow, you know, the idea that a man can actually take his job extremely seriously isn't a good enough excuse. And it fits into like the larger narrative we have at the moment. Of there was a great story on the Guardian this week about this ice sheet which is formed in a river in America, and it's formed this disc which rotates. And the science behind why it happens, but no, that's not good enough. It could be aliens, you know. So it's like a little example of like this thing we have in culture where, you know, science isn't good enough. It's got to be aliens or the supernatural or spying. So I find it quite a nice little story in that respect.
Yeah, I get all that, but being far more puerile than you, I'm
That's not what you normally say.
I'm going to Stoke tomorrow to see Leeds play, and I've got my binoculars. I've got a big felt hat and some sunglasses, because I do think that's the best approach to this story, is just to make fun of the EFL, because it's a nonsense that some guy stands in a public footpath and looks at a field of people practicing football, and it's the biggest scandal since Watergate. It's just such a nonsense. And so go on.
I was going to say, so people will be able to recognise you because you're the one who looks either like a spy or Audrey Hepburn.
Well, I certainly look like an idiot. Right, look, that really is enough football. Football is something that it takes me away from all this nonsense about news. So let's move on. Did you see the Gillette advert?
I watched it this morning twice.
For those that didn't, the Gillette advert is all these men suddenly realising that they're actually against bullying, you need to respect women. They've gone from the best a man can get, which is for 30 years has been their tagline, and they've replaced it with the best men can be. And it is part of this thing that Gillette has got. They're partnering with Building a Better Man project, putting in hundreds of thousands of dollars. It seeks to reduce violent behaviour in men. Now, that might be laudable, but they're still selling razor blades.
Bullying.
The Me Too movement against sexual harassment.
Toxic masculinity.
Is this the best a man can get? Is it? We can't hide from it.
Sexual harassment is taking over.
It's been going on far too long. We can't laugh it off.
Who's the daddy?
What I actually think she's trying to say.
Making the same old excuses.
Boys will be boys.
Boys will be boys.
Boys will be boys.
But something finally changed.
So what did you make of the whole ad and the furore around it?
Well, when I wrote down this morning, moralising, oversimplifying and using a serious issue to shift razor blades. So I agree. I mean, the people it's going to actually... Oh, it's attempting to speak to other people who are probably aware that and haven't been sexist over the years. And the people it really wants to try to get a message to, I don't think are going to be affected by it. So I just think it's like you say, ridiculous. It's just about selling razor blades.
I didn't say it was ridiculous.
But let me explain why I think it is ridiculous. I think it's ridiculous because I think in another 5 years they'll be back to selling razor blades using women kissing men's cheeks again. I just think it's another example of marketing exploiting a serious issue for their own trivial reasons.
I put it to you, Waywell, David Waywell. How dare you contradict Bernice King, daughter of the late civil rights legend Martin Luther King, who said, "This commercial isn't anti-male, it's pro-humanity." There.
Well, yes, so do I need a razor blade company to tell me to be pro-humanity? I've been pro-humanity all my life. I've been a rationalist, a humanist, and I don't need these people to tell me these messages. And, you know, I feel insulted that they think I can be won over by an advert which is actually quite insulting to men, because there's a shot in it where there's a line of men repeating the line "boys will be boys" as though we are unthinking creatures of our sex or of our gender, and we don't actually have opinions. I just find it frustratingly cloying and like I say, moralizing and oversimplifying, because although there has been a problem with toxic masculinity, it's not every man who has toxic masculinity. I mean, one of the lessons we've learned by gender theory, which we're told to embrace, is that there isn't such a thing as two genders. There's many types of gender, and gender identity is quite complex, and it's bound up into our social beings. So to say that, you know, I am somehow a victim of toxic masculinity, I don't think I've got any toxic masculinity in my life. I'll ask my girlfriend, but I don't think she would say I would class amongst those toxic males who are out there.
David, I was bullied horribly as a child.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I just thought I'd share that with you. Right, the voiceover says, because the boys watching today will be the men of tomorrow. Mark Bukowski, big ad exec guru, he said it's no longer enough for brands to simply sell a product. Customers, this is the bit I disagree with, customers are demanding they have a purpose, that they stand for something. No, I just like good, usually help, preferably funny ads. I don't need them to have a purpose.
Okay, if companies want to moralise about you know, all that nonsense, why are we buying our iPads from China, and why are we living a lifestyle in the West which is supported by a lot of extremely impoverished people making the products that we own?
You're the clever one.
Isn't this going back to the argument we had a few weeks ago about how Macron wants to increase fuel duties in France, and then people protest because they don't have the car, but he's actually doing it because he wants to readjust the economy to have a more environmental approach. There was a story the other day I read, which the headline read, would you be willing to save your planet by having only one rasher of bacon a day?
Sorry, didn't mean to laugh.
No, but it's true, isn't it? I mean,
yeah. Well, no, it is, because if you did only have one rasher of bacon a day, you would, if everybody did that, you would considerably cut down greenhouse gas emissions, and you would be helping to save the planet. Yeah.
Yeah, but of course it's true, but it comes back down to the question of people's selfishness. You expect everybody else to cut the bacon, but you're not going to cut it, are you?
That's a bit harsh. Anyway, going back to this ad. Conservative Canadian political commentator Ezra Levant wrote, a shaving ad written by pink-haired feminists, because it was written by a woman, a shaving ad written by pink-haired feminist scolds is about as effective as a tampon ad written by middle-aged men. People go off completely pop because, you know, I don't care if it was written by a woman, I just care about the ad, and I don't care if a middle-aged man writes an ad about a tampon.
Yeah, and I would imagine a lot of ads have been written by men in the past. But yeah, I don't follow that. I just think it's a rather silly. It's faddish, isn't it? It's just falling into a fad of this is what we're supposed to be. Isn't the word woke? We're all woke or something. I just think, you know, if you were aware of these issues before, and if you weren't aware of toxic masculinity, I don't think a Gillette advert is going to change your outlook on life.
I've got a slight... I mean, mostly I agree with you. There's a bit of me that thinks there may be a few guys that kind of see through osmosis of popular culture. I mean, there's the guy who's about to sort of, I don't know, wolf whistle a woman or you know, say, hey, babe, or whatever, and this guy says, hey, not cool. Which isn't very cool in itself, but you know, maybe through osmosis, there's a slight sort of, you know, we don't behave like that anymore.
Yeah. But that's okay. that's the argument, which is like hyper rationality. It's like the old, you know, if a butterfly flaps its wings in New York, there's a tidal wave in Tokyo. Yes, I mean that in theory can happen, and a one advert can change the world in a very slight way. But I just think there are bigger ways to change toxic masculinity.
And what is the sound of one hand clapping, David?
We can actually do it, I think.
Well, hang on a minute. Hang on, it's this. That was one hand, but it was on my thigh.
Oh, okay.
Right, ending on this bit. Nirpal Singh Dhaliwal is a journalist and author and wrote, the Gillette advert is as likely to get the average bloke to buy their razor blades as a video showing them being first used by heroin addicts. And I kind of like this style of writing sometimes. Supposedly championing the Me Too movement, it appeals only to slimy, pseudo-feminist creeps whose drippy Mr. Nice Guy routine is their signature move. It's the only tool in their box during their largely futile efforts to worm their way into women's knickers.
I think that is probably accurate, actually. I've known a few people. I've worked for a few people like that, and I think, yes, definitely.
Okay, finally, because I did like this style of writing. But maybe Gillette crafted the ad specifically for that lucrative and growing demographic of loveless men who spend Saturday nights indoors shaving their legs in preparation for that lonely long-distance Sunday morning bicycle ride along the canal to end up reading The Guardian on their own with their vegan pub lunch.
Well, I'm not going to comment on that bit.
He's nailed me in right there. Right, the news roundup, because...
Oh, God, you shave your legs. I didn't mean to...
No, I don't. Nor am I a vegan. The news roundup, because, as I said last week, I'm trying to cling on to the last vestiges of seriousness, and this is a geopolitical podcast.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Things we lost in the mire. Talks between the US and Russia on the future of the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty broke up without progress. Now, the Russians are developing a new cruise missile. They say it's not nuclear capable. The Americans worry that it is, say it violates the treaty, and they're threatening to pull out of the treaty February the 2nd. It's quite serious. It could lead to a bit of an arms race. The Turkish parliament has voted to grant President Erdogan emergency powers on economic policy. Basically, it's facing another currency crisis. This is an interesting one. About 300 people gathered in central Bishkek to protest against Chinese migrants in Kyrgyzstan. You don't do a great deal of, not you personally, of demonstrating in Kyrgyzstan, and to demonstrate against the Chinese is quite something. They demanded that Chinese migrants working illegally in the country are expelled. There's been an IED attack in the Colombian capital, Bogota. That's noteworthy because the civil war involving the FARC is supposed to be over. The attack left 8 people dead at a police academy. 2 more. The US Navy and British Navies completed their first joint naval drills in the South China Sea. Why does this matter? Looks like the UK is going to go all out in supporting the United States to push the guarantee of what's called freedom of passage through the international sea lanes. And it poses a question, will the UK send its new aircraft carrier there next year? My favourite story of the week, probably this. China says a cotton seed it planted in a climate-controlled capsule on the far side of the moon this month has sprouted a leaf. It's not the full Neil Armstrong, maybe, but, well, one small sprout for man, one leap for mankind. That was leaf, by the way. That was the little joke there for you, David. One leaf for mankind.
Yeah, so, you didn't mention the fact it died the next day, actually within hours.
Oh, thanks. That's not the point, is it? The point is someone grew something out.
Yeah, I know. I don't think it's necessarily the first time. I think we've been doing it for a while.
Well, China says it was the first one, and if China says it, that's good enough for me. Anyway, the overall point of the news in briefs, and tell me your thoughts, is all those, or rather none of those, got big headlines. I think that's the type of story, all of them, that give you the underlying trends or the... This is significant. It means there's something behind it. You know, that sort of thing.
It is actually the Chinese one is actually interesting because there's it's always been held that we try not to introduce foreign. I think there's like a real concern about adding, earth germs and viruses and organic material to other planets. And the Chinese seem to have got in there. I mean, there is a thing that is going to break down. The moon's surface is so toxic, and
yeah, but again, they didn't plant it in the what passes for soil. It was in a capsule. But the point about the story for me, David, is that if this was the first instance, and if it's not, sorry, but they said it was, and I believe everything the Chinese tell me, that is our future potentially. Terraforming or whatever it is, you know, going out there in 100, 200, whatever it years, and living out there. And it's not as momentous as Armstrong putting his foot on that planet, but it is momentous if, in fact, this turns out to be the very first time we did something like that, whereas in X hundred years' time, you know, allegedly over massive domes in some sci-fi type film, we'll be living like that.
Yeah, I agree to a certain extent, but the problem, the question about it is, What's interesting about it is, like, you've got other countries other than America and Russia going to the moon and doing these things on their own terms. I don't necessarily think it's terraforming. I mean, it could be a big thing, but I've always held the view that I'm not sure why we would want to travel and terraform, say, Mars, when we're probably better off staying here and fixing our climate here. It might be easier to fix our climate than create a new climate on another planet. But yeah, I love space stories. We should do more of them. I'm just a bit dubious about what the Chinese are up to.
You may have a point. Finally, almost, are morally virtuous people funny? David. Oh.
What do I say?
No, I ask because scientists writing, I'm sure you read this every week, the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, they say perhaps not. They researched a link between joke appreciation, joke making, and people's sense of their own morality, and concluded that although highly moral people are often viewed positively for displaying admirable character traits. Thank you. They may also be disliked to the extent to which they are viewed as sanctimonious, prudish, or unrelatable.
I respond to it in two ways, right? The first is like the obvious, like try to make sense of what they're saying, and in a very broad sense, they're probably right, because I think we all know those very moral people, churchgoers who aren't particularly funny. And the argument would be that comedy and humour is somehow involves a degree of transgression and to break the rules. And these people tend to live lives where they're inhibited by rules and don't really like to step out of the bounds of what's prescribed by society or their society. So in a sense, that might be right. But I would also turn it around that my evidence of that is actually the opposite. I think I've mentioned that a few years ago, I wrote these letters to all these famous people. And one of the reasons I did that actually is I wanted to see which of them had a sense of humour. And what I discovered was the people who I expected to get funny replies from, I very rarely did. And the people who did reply in a funny way are the people who surprised me. So archbishops, I had an almost 100% success rate with archbishops. Archbishop of Canterbury, Archbishop of York, Archbishop of Liverpool. Archbishop of Liverpool is very funny. Nuns, people in abbeys, monks, funny. I got a reply from the Pope, but I think that was more of a generic one. And what I kind of, the conclusion I came to was, I think humour isn't so much an act of transgression, it's a willingness to see the kind of complexity of life. And I did wonder whether people with a seriously religious habit of mind and not simple conformity to a religious lifestyle were aware of the kind of these kind of complexities of life and the absurdity of life. Because I think if you're religious, maybe that you are thinking about these bigger issues and the bigger concerns. So I'm a bit dubious whether I would sort of say everybody who lives a moral life isn't funny. I would say people who live a very bland life might not be very funny, and people who are very limited in their outlook. I think once you have a kind of a broader outlook of life and you understand like the absurdities of it, I think that's the essence of comedy. That's my long-winded answer to that simple question.
Have you finished?
Yeah.
I once farted in an elevator. It was wrong. It was wrong on so many levels.
Yeah. Go on. Next one.
Well, actually, that was one that was from their study. One I made up just yesterday was that I went to a binocular shop yesterday, but they saw me coming.
Oh, God.
And then when I was just working on a binocular and spy jokes because of the whole Spygate Leeds United thing, and then I thought, and then I was trying to find a hidden camera. I couldn't, et cetera, et cetera. Right.
Well, the question is whether you're the guinea pig here. I mean, if you live a moral life, we can now decide whether moral people are funny or not.
Ooh, I've got no answer to that other than knock knock.
Who's there?
Opportunity. Oh, it's impossible. God. Opportunity doesn't knock twice. Now, again, I think that's a rubbish joke. But they said that's the sort of inoffensive joke that the pious moral types obviously wouldn't have a problem with. I'd have a problem with it because it's not very funny. They also say that the pious moral types sometimes don't understand that humour is part of the glue of friendship. which I thought was a nice phrase.
Yeah, I'm a bit dubious about jokes, though. I'm not a great... I find those kind of jokes, the kind of cracker jokes, I never find them that funny, and I don't know whether that's a problem with me or a problem with the joke.
I think I know the answer to that.
The only one I do like is what's long, brown and sticky.
A stick,
yeah. You
know. Two weasels sitting on a bar stool. One starts to insult the other. He screams, "I slept with your mother!" The bar goes very quiet. Everybody waits to see what the other weasel will do. And then again, he yells, "I slept with your mother!" And the other weasel says, "Go home, Dad, you're drunk."
Yeah, that was from the report, actually. That's the one that they held up as an example of transgressive and...
Yeah, well, I can think of a lot more transgressive ones than that.
Yeah, it's not exactly Derek and Clive.
No. The solution, we're not suggesting that employees should compromise their values or violate moral standards to be funny and gain like... they lost me at that point. Right.
Yeah, it goes into this whole thing about management, how management can kind of engage with the workers by... It's ridiculous. It's like these people who... If you try to be funny in that sense, you're probably not funny. It's to do with your character and like I said, I think it's to do with your world outlook. And if you lack that... that ability to see the kind of plurality of life's experiences, that you're probably not ever going to see a good joke.
I'm inclined to agree with you. I couldn't find any decent World's Worst Spam email this week, so I'm afraid we are straight on to...
Oh, actually, no, let me at least make the take this space to...
We've got
a letter. Oh, we've got a comment on the blog. From Adam Curtis. I don't think it's the Adam Curtis, but...
Sorry, who's Adam Curtis?
Adam Curtis did some great TV documentaries on the BBC about advertising and...
No, he's that bloke who wrote you a letter. Get on with it.
Oh, I know, sorry. there are, in fact, he writes, 32 different Disney propaganda films, because Disney propaganda films. They were made because Disney was facing bankruptcy, and so they took out an American government contract to make them. He goes on to say, "My favourite is Education for Death, a short film about a boy called Hans, who is brainwashed from being an innocent child into a killing machine." I'll put the link in there.
Yeah, that's worth knowing. I mean, like I said, I only knew of the Donald Duck Disney propaganda, you know, anti-Germany pro. That's a tops, and thank you very much, Adam.
I would recommend. I watched the Education for Death one, and it's actually brilliant because it mixes this really kind of stylized graphic, like a kind of graphic novel, and then sort of descends into absolute farce. It's great. It's really funny, like, but at the same time, deadly serious bit of propaganda.
Sold. I look forward to that. Thank you. Are you holding on to your chair?
I always do.
It's time for this week's facts.
Jean a de longue moustache. Je répète. Jean a de longue moustache.
Je répète. Jean has a long moustache. Why am I saying this?
Because we're invading Europe again.
No, we were liberating Europe.
Well, okay, liberating.
Thank
Europe,
you. Yeah, that's true. So you get that reference?
It's the resistance in France, wasn't it? We always used to use these weird, like, the chicken is standing on top of the cockerel and things like that.
That particular one is from the film The Longest Day, and it meant, right, you know, that's it. They're about to... about to invade. But why have I chosen that for this week's facts? What are this week's facts about, David?
Oh, God, spying?
It's funny you should say that.
Actually, my name is Austin Powers.
It says your name, Danger Powers.
No. Danger's my middle name.
This week's facts are about spying. Many of the things which seem to come out of an Austin Powers movie are actually real. Gloves which fire a bullet? Check. Cold War US intelligence officers had access to a glove with a single bullet firing action. If arrested, surrender, put your hands behind your head, then punch the person arresting you and voila, the bullet fires at gross point blank range. Killer lipstick, check. One turn of the lipstick holder, one bullet fired. Killer umbrellas, check. Actually happened in London. That wasn't a check, it was a Bulgarian. Radio transmitter in shoe, check. Suicide glasses, check. Spectacles fitted with a pellet of cyanide in the arms. So you get arrested, you chew on that, and say goodbye to torture misery forever. Invisible ink, check. originally wrote written on paper, right? So then you steam the paper, you let it dry, then you re-steam it to remove indentations, let it dry, and then you write on top of it to cover original writing. Yeah. Later on, you invent disappearing ink. History. Elizabeth I had a spy chief. Francis...
Drake? I don't know. I'm sorry, I'm still thinking about invisible ink, to be honest with you.
I'm sorry. No, look, he's just a favourite of mine. It's Walsingham, Francis
Walsingham. Oh, Walsingham, yeah. Go on, move on. I was going to go into some pretty filthy facts about disappearing ink.
No, this is a clean podcast. He formed a network of spies around Europe. Many were recruited from Oxford and Cambridge University. Who'd have thunk it, eh? That has actually changed a lot now because the demographics changed. Anyway, coded letters. Some codes could only be understood by placing a sheet of paper, this is what Walsingham came up with, punched with holes over the top so that the relevant letters making up the message could be read. And this was you had to calculate the exact sequence of thousands of holes. And, this is in Elizabeth's time. He also did a bit of invisible ink stuff written in milk or lemon juice. It could be read when they were warmed over a candle. Now, I thought that Walsingham was the spy that paid agents to check Queen Mary's bed sheets to see if she was having a period every month. Because, they didn't want her to have a baby to be an heir to the throne. And I couldn't find it. So I was wondering if, did I just see that in some film or other? Do you know anything on that?
Nothing on that. I don't know much. I do know that you can make invisible ink out of urine. I just checked. I didn't want to throw that into the podcast. It might have been a fake news. But yeah, you can actually make invisible ink from urine.
Same ballpark. Right, to the Americas. Sarah Edmonds, a white Canadian woman, worked for the Union Army during the American Civil War, and she managed to infiltrate Confederate territory in Virginia disguised as a black man. Robert Baden-Powell.
Yeah, Scoutman.
Thank you. Went on to be a scout. He was a British intelligence agent stationed in Malta who posed as a butterfly collector and hid the plans of military installations in his drawings of butterfly wings. This is my favourite. In 1917, the Germans built a 25-foot-tall armour-plated fake tree and stationed a soldier in it for months to spy on Allied artillery positions. Now, I don't believe the next bit of the story, which is that once the Brits took that area, they didn't notice it was a fake tree for 7 months.
Well, I believe it, because if it's a fake tree, it's going to look like a tree. I mean, you're not going to make a fake tree look like a fake tree. It's not going to look like the fake trees you had in Dad's Army or, these spy movies where there's a set of legs sticking out and just like, I Spy, is it the film with, Get Smart, the one where Bill Murray dresses as a tree and he's just got his face sticking out the tree.
Margaretha Zella McLeod. No, me neither, but she was better known by her stage name, Mata Hari. Yeah, Mata Hari. And she was or she wasn't a spy for Germany, but either way, she was sentenced to death by a French court, and get this, before the firing squad shot her, she blew a kiss to them. It's quite cool. All right. Jazz artist Josephine Baker worked with the French resistance during World War II. She would recount conversations overheard from German officers and smuggle secret documents written in invisible ink. I don't know if any urine was involved in this, but she wrote them in invisible ink. The word Lollapalooza was used by American soldiers in the Pacific to identify Japanese spies, because even if they'd had extensive English language training, they probably hadn't come across Lollapalooza.
That's a good one.
Okay. Chevalier Dion was a French spy, diplomat, and lady-in-waiting who infiltrated the court of Empress Elizabeth of Russia. It was only after her death in 1810 that it was discovered she was a man. During the Napoleonic Wars, a French ship ran aground in Hartlepool. The sole survivor was a monkey wearing a French soldier's uniform. And you know the rest. The Hartlepool residents captured the monkey, tried him for espionage, and hanged him as a spy. To this day, actually, in football circles, Hartlepool fans are known as monkey hangers.
Quickly. Is that true?
If you ever talk about a Hartlepool fan, you say, oh yeah, he's a monkey hanger. Like a Sunderland fan is a Mackham. A Hartlepool fan is a monkey hanger. In 2008, don't worry, it's the last one, Iranian security forces detained two suspected spy pigeons near the Natanz nuclear facilities. One had metal rings and invisible string attached to it. What is invisible string? Can't see it myself. Suggesting that they might have been somehow communicating with the equipment, which I can't resist saying that they were probably planning a coup.
Oh, God. God.
I'm here all week, David.
Try the chicken. Unfortunately.
Try the chicken. Right, that's it. Anything else?
I don't think so. I mean, I wish I had some spy facts of my own. I actually did finish reading The Spy and the Traitor recently. You know, I mentioned it a couple of podcasts ago, and the interesting fact I discovered about spies was how the Americans completely cocked up the British, one of the best British spy operations, when they desperately wanted to know the identify Oleg Gordievsky, and it was the Americans who identified him by working it all out, and it was Aldrich Ames
who
passed it on to the Russians. So I found that a fascinating little fact, because you always hear it's the British ruining the you know it's the British who've got the leakers, but no, actually America does it as well.
I shall leave you with one of the greatest spy tunes of the previous century, from the height of the Cold War. Thank you, David. See you next week.
Okay.
And here is the Anton Karas tune from The Third Man.
Sight. A colourful phrase used by a charismatic figure.
This is the Trump shutdown.
Thank you, God bless you, and God bless the nations of the world.